Good evening and welcome to Ave Maria University. I'm Bill Kirk, the university's Vice President for Legal Affairs and General Counsel. I die the King's good servant and God's first. Those were the words of St. Thomas More as he was led to his execution in 1535. In the funeral mass for Justice Scalia, his son, Father Paul Scalia, recalled the words of the saint for whom his father most assuredly had a devotion. He spoke of how his father was blessed by God with the desire to be the country's good servant. And so, with this symposium, our university joyfully celebrates the life and legacy of Justice Antonin Scalia. Like St. Thomas More, Justice Scalia distinguished himself by his constant fidelity to legitimate authority and institutions precisely in his intention to serve, not power, but the supreme ideal of justice. When Thomas More was proclaimed the patron of statesmen and people in public life by Pope St. John Paul II in the year 2000, the Holy Father spoke words that I think can fairly paraphrase Justice Scalia's life as well. His life teaches us that government is above all an exercise of virtue. Unwavering in this rigorous moral stance, he placed his own public activity at the service of the person and dealt with social controversies with a superb sense of fairness. His profound detachment from honors and wealth, his serene and joyful humility, his balanced knowledge of human nature and of the vanity of success, his certainty of judgment rooted in faith, these all gave him that confident inner strength that sustained him in adversity. His goodness shone forth as it had been prepared by an entire life of work devoted to God and neighbor. Like St. Thomas More, Justice Antonin Scalia was most certainly our country's good servant, and it was because he was God's first. But having said that, Justice Scalia's jurisprudence, as it relates to moral truth and the natural law, is quite complex, as we shall soon hear. And so, we're honored to have with us tonight two esteemed academics, popular and public intellectuals. Our limited time doesn't allow me to provide you a complete account of their scholarship and service, but I'll mention a few highlights. First, Professor Jerry Bradley, professor of law at the University of Notre Dame, where he teaches legal ethics and constitutional law. Professor Bradley directs, along with John Finnis, the Natural Law Institute. A Cornell Law School summa cum laude graduate, Professor Bradley served in the Manhattan District Attorney's Office and joined the law faculty at Notre Dame in 1992. He's published over 100 scholarly articles and reviews and edited several collections of essays dealing with law, religion, morality, and the public engagement of lay Catholics. He's currently working on a book regarding the regulation of obscenity in the internet age. Personally, I can credit Professor Bradley to a not insignificant degree for getting me to Ave Maria, or perhaps more accurately, getting me out of Notre Dame. It's my great pleasure to welcome to Ave Maria University my friend, Professor Jerry Bradley.
Well, you're probably wondering what exactly it is I did to get Bill fired from Notre Dame. I did. It is true. And you'll have to wait to the end of the lecture. I'm just going to tease you for the moment. But I talked Bill into doing something which got him fired at Notre Dame. But he's landed on his feet. And frankly, I think we can see the hand of Providence in his departure from Notre Dame. But I want to thank Bill most sincerely for organizing this event, for putting it all together, for all of those other people who helped make it the evening that I'm sure it's going to be. Special thanks to Jim Tuohy, a man whom I've long admired, and wish him all the best in building this great institution. And perhaps a very special joy it is for me to be on a panel, a small one, with my dear longtime friend Hadley Arkes. I realize I'm the warm-up for Hadley. You can think of me as Ed McMahon. Those of you who are old enough to know who Johnny Carson was. And those of you even older, I say I don't mind being his Bud Abbott, his Lou Costello. Or perhaps it's the other way around, who's to say. But let me talk about Antonin Scalia. His death was noticed as widely as one would expect it to be noticed. For a man who stood astride our constitutional law for three decades, and who, because of what constitutional law has come to mean in America, a man who stood astride our whole political culture for three decades. He was also a larger-than-life figure in more classic terms, a mensch, eminently clubbable, relentlessly energetic, and very sociable. He was a devoted father and faith-filled Catholic, and he was eminently quotable. In preparing these remarks, I was moved a couple of weeks ago to do an idle, a rambling Google search on Antonin Scalia. I discovered, among many other things, that there are about a half a dozen websites devoted exclusively to the best or most memorable quotations by Antonin Scalia. Now, that's more than the number of websites devoted to the sayings of Dr. Samuel Johnson, but still fewer than the websites devoted to the quotes of another great Italian-American, Lawrence Yogi Berra. Now, in the Justice's case, though, we can be sure that what he is said to have said, he really did say. You can find these quotes in the reported opinions of his court, journal articles, or on YouTube recordings of his speeches. With Yogi, not so much. But one very improbable Yogiism is comprised of these directions, which Yogi is said to have given. Keep going this way until you come to a fork in the road, then take it. Now, not only did Yogi really say that, and he did really say that, evidently it's also true. The road near Yogi's Montclair, New Jersey home split into two, but each fork actually got you to his house. Now, I did not know Antonin Scalia very well personally. I was an acquaintance, spent just a few blocks of time with him. One of those blocks is especially relevant to this occasion. It was in the last weekend of March of 1999. It was in Ann Arbor, and it was, I don't know if it was the first, but it was surely the key planning meeting for the launch of Ave Maria Law School. The meeting, which Antonin Scalia attended, I attended. Tom Monahan was there, Bernie Dobransky, the late founding president and founding dean of the law school. The four or five young men and women who were going to be the beginning faculty and some other people, we all gathered to talk about a Catholic legal education and what the curriculum, especially for a Catholic law school, would look like. This affair was followed, as almost all of Tom's affairs are followed, by a wonderful and scrumptious dinner in the shack, which is Tom's hideaway in the woods near Ann Arbor. But Antonin Scalia was really quite an avid participant in the discussions and showed not only a polite interest in the project of a Catholic law school, but really a deep and abiding interest, and remained a friend of Ave Maria Law School for the rest of his life. But I think my first encounter with Justice Scalia merits also a brief mention. And before I turn to the heart of my remarks about his impact on our law, especially with regard to moral truth and the law and religion and public life. But the first time I met Antonin Scalia was at Notre Dame in 1994. A venerable, accomplished philosopher then on our faculty who passed away about 4.5 years ago, Ralph McInerney, organized a meeting or a seminar on the Notre Dame campus to discuss U.S. political and legal affairs, which weren't going very well, even in 1994. And it was really a gathering of Catholics, both academics like myself and people who have real jobs, like Antonin Scalia. Henry Hyde was there. Bob Casey, the great pro-life Democrat governor of Pennsylvania, back when there was such a thing as a pro-life Democrat. Michael Novak was there. And I had prepared a paper for that meeting, which was attributed in advance to the participants, on the Supreme Court's contributions, such as they were, to the present, that is, then-present crisis in law and morality. And I wrote, now mind you, this was 20 years ago, that before you know it, this was in my paper, before you know it, newlyweds will move in next door to you. One will be a fighter pilot, the other an Episcopal priest. Both will be women. Well, Justice Scalia read this paper of mine on a plane coming to South Bend, and I think the first thing he said to me when I met him for the first time at this meeting was that he laughed so loudly on the plane that the people in the seats near him were staring him down. Now, I meant it at the time, I was really half kidding, and now it's no joke at all. And perhaps we'll miss Antonin Scalia most dearly on this precise subject, same-sex marriage, and the court's disastrous decision requiring it across the country last June in the Obergefell case. The court made it the law of the land. Now I'm teaching my students tomorrow that very case, Obergefell versus Hodges, at 3:45 tomorrow in room 3130 of the law school in South Bend. If you happen to be nearby, just stop in and you can hear what I have to say about it. But I think we'll miss Justice Scalia on this precise subject of same-sex marriage in three ways or for three reasons. And I'm talking about going forward. So for the moment, I'm not talking about his heroic and strident even dissent in the case last June. But going forward, with him gone, we've lost a vote to overrule this Obergefell decision, which, if he had survived the next retirement or death on the Supreme Court, could have resulted in the appointment of a new sound-minded replacement for, say, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Of course, that hypothesis, that is, if Justice Scalia had survived the next justice's death or retirement, maybe Ruth Bader Ginsburg, a better justice would have been appointed if there was a Republican succeeding Barack Obama. Now, you can judge for yourself how likely that is to happen now. But the decision last June was 5-4. And one justice swing in a Republican administration would give us a chance to reverse that decision. Now, that's not going to happen. Now, Justice Scalia's brutally frank and almost apocalyptic dissent last June focused mainly upon the threat to American democracy posed by the court's activism imposing same-sex marriage on the country. In a certain way, the decision, his dissent, was less about same-sex marriage, exactly speaking, than about what the court imposing it on America meant for American law and democracy. His dissent amounted to a clarion call for other branches of government to resist, by all lawful means, the same-sex marriage juggernaut. But now Justice Scalia will not be around to promote that resistance. Third, assuming that same-sex marriage is here to stay, Justice Scalia would have been indispensable to properly integrating it with religious liberty. Now, on that subject, I say the following in what I hope are carefully chosen words, and I mean this even though it may sound strange to you. But I do say that because marriage in our culture before last June was already so degraded and decrepit and had lost its sort of pride of place in our culture. The worst part about the same-sex marriage decision is not, I think, crowning this degradation or corruption of marriage with same-sex marriage, although that's very bad. I believe the greater terrible effect of Obergefell is yet to be felt. It won't be felt on the family, but upon religion, religious liberty, and religious institutions. Now, that's to compare not better and not so good, but bad and even worse. But the worst effect will be on religious liberty. But let me talk about Justice Scalia's impact, this is first, impact on constitutional law. Leave aside what might have been, what could have happened. Now, I put the most obvious measure of his impact on constitutional law in the form of a question to five acquaintances or friends of mine, three academics and two people working, lawyers all, and three were former clerks to Justice Scalia. And all were friends, if not admirers, of Justice Scalia. But the question I asked them was, in which cases did the justice write for a majority of the court, so wrote the opinion of the court, and in doing so laid down a new doctrine or set the path, marked the path for a new direction in the law? So the question was really, when, in which case, did the justice write the opinion of the court in a way that was significantly moving the law from point A to, say, point B? And these were five admirers of the justice. And you could count those cases on one hand in 30 years. I'll name them just to show you I'm not cheating or just guesstimating. The Prince case, P-R-I-N-T-Z, excuse me, a 1997 federalism case had to do with the Brady gun law. basically standing for a sound proposition about the limits of Congress's authority under the Constitution to commandeer state officials to enforce federal law. I think it will stand and last, but I think its impact is limited. In the Confrontation Clause, starting with Crawford versus Washington in 2006, I think, this doctrinal departure led by Justice Scalia limits the use of hearsay testimony in criminal trials. It's an interpretation of the Confrontation Clauses in the Sixth Amendment. It means that the defendant gets to confront in person, in real time, the witnesses against him and have an opportunity to cross-examine those witnesses. And as I say, limits the opportunity or the capacity of the prosecutors to try a defendant through the use of documents or hearsay testimony, where the real witness, so to speak, is removed, one step removed from the courtroom. Justice Scalia memorably said in the first of these cases, dispensing with confrontation, because testimony is obviously reliable, is akin to dispensing with jury trial, because a defendant is obviously guilty. I think this set of cases, this line of cases, will last, but I think it's destined to be chipped away. The scope of the holdings will be narrowed. Oregon v. Smith, a very unpopular and controversial 1990 free exercise case, I think will last, although it remains unpopular, especially among religious conservatives. Finally, the Heller case, the gun control case, or the gun rights case. This is probably Justice Scalia's greatest triumph. 2008, he relied upon a very historically grounded reading of the Second Amendment right to bear arms to there lead the court, a court majority, to hold that individuals have a right to bear arms, own arms, for self-defense, and that very, very strict gun control laws, like those in New York, for example, could be unconstitutional. I think, his moment of triumph, but this will be number one on the new court's hit list, so a note to voters. Assuming there's a Democratic appointed justice in place this time next year, Heller will be among the first targets of the new court. But that's about it. Now, this limited roster of signal victories would be no surprise to Antonin Scalia. And some of you may have seen what our friend Robbie George wrote in this particular regard in National Review about 3 issues ago. National Review had a cover story in a symposium about the justice. And Robbie had something to say that's pertinent to this limited roster of great victories. This is Robbie George, a Princeton professor and friend of ours, talking. The last time I saw Nino was a few months ago, when the two of us conducted a public conversation on the Constitution in Philadelphia. There was a poignant moment that evening, one that the audience did not witness. Nino was given an appropriately lengthy and elaborate introduction, noting Justice Scalia's brilliance, the depth and breadth of his learning, the analytical rigor of his thinking, the elegance of his writing, and so forth. Nino turned to me and said, "If I'm so wonderful, why am I so often on the losing side?" Well, just so. It's a pretty good question. But does that mean this limited roster, Robbie's rendition of what Scalia said to him, does this mean that his influence, that Justice Scalia's influence might prove to be fleeting, interesting only to historians within a decade or two? No, I think not. Now, one reason is that great dissents sometimes presage the development of new law. Some of the most famous Supreme Court opinions in history have been dissents. Maybe some of the justices' dissents will lead the way someday to a change in the law and be the foundation of a majority holding. But more important, it seems to me that my question to the 5 friends of mine about which cases were signal victories was not a bad one, it just wasn't the right one. I think Antonin Scalia was playing a broad game and a long game. He was dedicated to the Constitution, and though he liked winning, it wasn't his objective to win. A long game and a broad game. One seminarian who attended a lecture by Justice Scalia in Rome in 1996 at the Gregorian University, at a time when his son Paul Scalia was a student there. This lecture at the Greg, included a Q&A, and during the Q&A, a seminarian who said he was an American law school graduate in 1990 said, and now I'm quoting from the account of this Q&A that I found in Origins from 1996. But the seminarian said to Justice Scalia, "For me, and I know a lot of others, you are a means of perseverance for us in a sometimes hostile environment, the way American law schools are these days. Also, I wanted you to know that your opinions have a lot of respect, even of those who do not agree with you." I think Antonin Scalia wrote for students, for the public, for other people working in government, especially in legislative branches, for future courts, and for himself in this sense, for the sake of getting the Constitution right, which I do submit to you was his overriding and enduring objective. But his influence on law students and in the academy more generally may be his lasting mark on the law, but because it's a mark on students and professors, so tomorrow's lawyers and today's shapers of students and opinion, his effects through the law schools may be magnified, but I think many times over, by their shaping of American law. Antonin Scalia was a pillar and focal point of what we now call the conservative legal movement, the Federalist Society, and many other institutions and groups and associations. The conservative legal movement, from a standing start in around 1983, has grown into a respectable, very formidable, substantial minority party in legal education, constitutional scholarship, popular constitutional culture, and among lawyers and judges of all ages. And I think Antonin Scalia has more to do with that than any other one person, and probably more than any other two people put together. Okay, two, my second topic, moral truth and constitutional law. Now, Justice Scalia has been an invaluable companion to this constitutional law teacher for 30 years. I started teaching constitutional law in 1984 in Champaign-Urbana, Illinois. Justice Scalia elevated to the Supreme Court in 1986, so we've been together about 30 years. He has been invaluable to me in identifying, for my students, the moral truth relevant to a particular Supreme Court decision. Oddly, he did not, I repeat, did not consistently rely upon the moral truth as the basis for his decisions. Now, let me explain. Antonin Scalia shared and indeed mightily contributed to the central weakness, in my opinion, of conservative constitutionalism since Roe versus Wade. This is the edifice of originalism and judicial restraint built up by Bob Bork, Ed Meese, Scalia, and others, which on the whole has been an enormous benefit to the American people, and which on the whole is greatly preferable to its liberal counterpart, which is usually called the living Constitution. But there is a weakness in this preferable and good conservative constitutionalism. Simply put, the weakness is that while moral truth has less to do with constitutional adjudication than the liberals think, it has a bit more to do with constitutional adjudication than conservatives like Scalia think. Now again, Justice Scalia was hardly diffident about the existence of moral truths, and he surely held many of them, those the church proposed to him for his assent. He held all of them, but in a certain important way, they were cabined for him while writing opinions in which he made law. Now, it's easy to sympathize with his situation, with his point of view, although ultimately I think this part of his judicial philosophy should be rejected. He was educated at Harvard Law School, late 50s, at a time when legal process was the vogue. And in that way of educating law students, morality was purely conventional. Morality was a function of consensus in society, and the idea of there being moral truths at all would not surface in the course of a three-year law school education. So he had no opportunity to be formed in any kind of productive way where he could integrate the existence of moral truth into his legal philosophy. Where he was educated, that simply wasn't on the menu of options. Justice Scalia found some roots for his view about moral truth and lawmaking, also in his understanding of democratic theory, where he seems to have held a view something like the government in a democracy is itself, in some primitive or natural state, morally obtuse. It doesn't really know anything morally, but the government democracy should be receptive to receiving the morality of a majority of the people in that country. Now, I recommend to you, if you want to explore this part of his thinking a little bit more, to find a copy of his prepared remarks to the Greg in 1996. I don't recommend his conclusions. I think his understanding of democracy is flawed. But to get more about what he thought, that would be the place to look. Lastly, I can sympathize readily, especially because I've taught constitutional law for 30 years, with where he came to, his originalism and what I'm calling his limited use of moral truth. Justice Scalia came to the courts, I guess in 83, first appointed to the courts, and he looked around and wondered what had gone wrong with constitutional law since around 1960, when school prayer went, when abortion came in, when all sorts of morals laws were on the outs, when pornography became effectively legalized. And his diagnosis of what went wrong with the Warren Court up through the Roe years was the same as Bob Bork's and Ed Meese's and the other constitutional conservatives. Their view, in a nutshell, was what went wrong was that judges started engaging in moralizing, that judicial philosophizing is what gave us Roe versus Wade and other terrible results. They drew the conclusion, or at least developed the response to this diagnosis. The way to beat it back and to get things aright was to stop judicial philosophizing, stop judicial moralizing. We'll have no more of it. So this polemical position in which he found himself contributed to a view, and it was his view, that moral truth would not be the ground of constitutional law. So he came to his view honestly, and it has its limitations. I'll leave those aside to say what I prefer to focus on this evening, given the nature of this occasion, was that even so, he was a wonderful companion to my law students. Because while not in support of holdings for the majority about what the law shall be, Antonin Scalia regularly talked about moral truth in his judicial opinions, usually in dissent, sometimes in concurrences. But he would talk about moral truth, moral reality, to rebut or refute liberal justices moralizing, or to expose and then explode the unarticulated, operative moral presupposition of liberal results. So let me give you some examples of what I mean. Where Justice Scalia relied upon, in dissent especially, the moral truth that he held. It was as if dissent freed him up to speak candidly and a bit intuitively about the morality and the law in a way that he couldn't do in his majority opinions. So in one case from 1990, Minnick versus Mississippi, Scalia defied a generation of pundits, judges, and commentators, including conservatives, by asserting that a suspect's, a criminal defendant's, voluntary confession served not only the state or the police or the prosecutors, because, oh, we've got a confession, therefore we'll get a conviction. Scalia said, confessing, if it's freely done, is good for the suspect. It's good for him or her because the person purges himself, herself of guilt. Now, you can find that in Aquinas. You can find it in the Catechism. You won't find it in the U.S. reports, except, I think, here. Now, in cases much more recently, two cases involving the Sixth Amendment and right to counsel and plea bargaining, he launched really quite a developed and sustained almost diatribe about what he saw was the immorality of plea bargaining. He allowed that plea bargaining in criminal cases was, at best, a necessary evil. And in dissent in those cases, he developed a long critique on moral grounds of our system of plea bargaining, which accounts for something like 94 or 95% of all the criminal convictions in this country. He rightly saw in the Cruzan case from 1989 that the issue was not, as his liberal colleague said it was, letting someone die. That was the trope that the liberals used when talking about this issue, the issue presented in Cruzan. He said, quite frankly, the issue is not letting someone die, it's killing them. It's assisted suicide or just plain homicide. In Lawrence v. Texas, the 2003 right to sodomy case, yes, you heard that right. In 2003, the Supreme Court found a right to sodomy in the Constitution. Justice Scalia wrote in dissent, "Today's opinion is the product of a court, which is the product itself of a law profession culture, which has largely signed on to the so-called homosexual agenda, by which I mean the agenda promoted by some homosexual activists directed at eliminating the moral opprobrium that has traditionally attached homosexual conduct." Justice Scalia was a reliable defender of all sorts of morals laws and of the whole idea of there being morals laws. The best example of this, a quote which I'll just give you bits of, comes from a case in 1991 where Indiana, where I live, was trying to make the girls who were dancing naked down at the Kitty Cat Lounge on South Michigan Street. Anybody? No. Nobody here. The Kitty Cat Lounge on South Michigan and South Bend, the girls wanted to dance with no clothes on, and the state law required them to cover up a little bit. These were go-go girls or whatever they call them. And the court majority upheld Indiana's law making the girls cover up a little bit. But now he's talking about the liberal dissenters who would have overturned, struck down even this modest law. So here's Scalia speaking about the liberals. "The dissent confidently asserts that the purpose of restricting nudity in public places is to protect non-consenting parties from offense. Perhaps the dissenters believe that offense to others ought to be the only reason for restricting nudity in public places generally. But there is no basis for thinking that our society has ever shared that Thoreauvian you may do what you like so long as it does not injure someone else, beau ideal, much less for thinking this ideal was written into the Constitution. The purpose of Indiana's nudity law would be violated," Scalia said, "if 60,000 fully consenting adults crowded into the Hoosier Dome to display their private parts to one another, even if there was not an offended innocent in the crowd. Our society prohibits, and all human societies have prohibited certain activities, not because they harm others, but because they are considered, in the traditional phrase, contra bonis mores, immoral. And in American society, such prohibitions are legion." Lastly, and briefly, religion and public life. Justice Scalia has been roundly criticized from both the right and the left, but in this case, especially from the right, from religious conservatives, a lot of criticism has come, for a 1990 case in which he wrote the majority opinion, cutting back, true, on free exercise doctrine. Now, I happen to think that criticism is itself undeserved, but it is widespread. But I should like to close these remarks by saying that notwithstanding this case in 1990, Justice Scalia is the best Supreme Court justice we have had since the modern era of church-state jurisprudence began in 1947 on the question of religion and public life. Again, since 1947, when the modern era began, Scalia is the best we have ever had. Admittedly, the competition is largely not very keen for that distinction, but there is competition, and it's no small achievement. Now, a reasonable defense or an adequate defense of that bold claim will take much more time than I have remaining to me this evening, so you'll have to come back to the sequel for this production. If Jim or Bill or anybody would have me back, I'll give it to you. But for now, let me say something very briefly about why I think he's the best justice we've ever had on religion and public life. As early as 1993, he got the Establishment Clause exactly right. So the two religion clauses in the First Amendment are free exercise, about which I've spoke already. The Establishment Clause is a much more important and bigger one, and he got it exactly right. He said, beginning in 1993, in an opinion he wrote for himself and Justice Thomas, that the Establishment Clause means that the government can't show favoritism to any particular church, denomination, or religion. it would be no preference among the churches or religions. He rejected then and has on every pertinent occasion since, and in season and out of season, argued forcefully against the alternative view, which remains the master principle of Establishment Clause law. This master principle is that the government must not only be neutral among the various churches, but must also be neutral between religion altogether and something the court calls non-religion. Now, if wrapping your mind around that comparison is a challenge at this hour, simply think secularism. The alternative view is secularism, a naked public square. But Scalia rejected it and has argued forcefully against it. And I'll conclude this part of my remarks by citing his 2005 opinion in Ten Commandments case, a case arising in Kentucky, in which he skillfully articulated the basis for the robust presence of religion in the public square in a way that didn't favor any particular church, but nonetheless gave a foundation for and a defense of In God We Trust, prayers on public occasions, the motto on our currency, and the Pledge of Allegiance. But I conclude with this. Let me return to what Justice Scalia said when he was with Robbie George in Philadelphia, whenever this was, 9 months ago. He talked about how come I lose all the time. And I don't want to say anything more about why he lost all the time, but I want to ask and answer a question about how does a person sustain himself and sustain himself in just a spirited and frankly good-natured way after 30 years of losing? Okay, you'd have to be at least a Cubs fan or not even a Mets fan to know what it's like to live through 30 years of losing. Now, I think the answer here is not Justice Scalia's belief in the Constitution or the rectitude of interpreting it correctly, as much as he believed in those things. Why did Justice Scalia hang in there and stand tall, keep the faith? Why or how did he keep his head when all about him were losing their heads and blaming it on him? Well, in a speech to the Knights of Columbus in Baton Rouge, Louisiana in 2005, he said something that I don't know that was intended to answer that question, but I think it is an answer to that question. How does a person make a go of it as a perennial loser? He said, and I'm quoting Justice Scalia, "God assumed from the beginning that the wise of the world would view Christians as fools, and God has not been disappointed. If I have brought any message today, it is this. Have the courage to have your wisdom regarded as stupidity. Be fools for Christ, and have the courage to suffer the contempt of the sophisticated world."
Thank you very much, Professor Bradley. Our second speaker, I'm pleased to introduce. Professor Hadley Arkes was the Edward Ney Professor of Jurisprudence at Amherst College, holding that chair until his retirement from there last year. But he has hardly retired from writing and speaking. He now carries his teaching into his role as the founder and director of the James Wilson Institute on Natural Rights and the American Founding. Professor Arkes is a prolific writer with frequent contributions to National Review, The Wall Street Journal, and other national publications, including First Things, the journal that took its name from one of his seven books. One of these books, Natural Rights and the Right to Choose, includes as an epilogue an account of Professor Arkes's experience and heroic efforts as the main advocate and architect of the bill that became known as the Born Alive Infants Protection Act, signed into law by President Bush in 2002 with Professor Arkes in attendance. Professor Arkes was a very close friend of Justice Scalia's, and so we're honored to hear some of his memories of Nino as he weaves an account, a portrait of his dear friend that will reflect on his warm nature and sterling character. Please join me in welcoming Professor Hadley Arkes.
Thanks for that lovely introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, a couple of weeks ago, I was at a spiffy dinner in Washington giving awards, And one of the honorees had a line there, which I'm sure was contrived, but it was good enough to repeat. He told his wife, "Could you ever imagine in your wildest dreams that I would get this honor?" And she said, "Darling, I don't know how to convey this to you, but you're not in my wildest dreams." I'm probably not in your wildest dreams, but I'm pleased to have to take this honor and have to be here tonight. I heard that voice for the first time over the phone. He said, "Hadley, this is Nino Scalia." I never met him, but already he put us on a first name basis. And for him, that was a generous gesture. It was May 1977, good God, almost 40 years ago. I was finishing a fellowship at the Smithsonian Institution, the lovely old Castle Building in Washington. I was offering a paper as a final from the final seminar, and Nino had agreed to come in to do a comment on the paper. He just left the government when the Ford administration was turned out of office, or as he used to put it, where the people threw us out. He'd been the head of the Office of Legal Counsel, the Department of Justice, the most important office giving advice to the president on matters of constitutionality. He was in residence then at the American Enterprise Institute on his way to my favorite law school, the University of Chicago. And curiously, what he came to say that day in his comments on my paper 39 years ago will become the source of persistent arguments over the years. But I leap ahead here to a day in the late 90s when he asked me to give a talk for him at a meeting of the Italian American Association in Washington. He called this the Top WAP Award. And my opening for the talk was one he really loved, and I repeat it to you only because he did love it. I was drawing on a clipping from my friend Mike Uhlman from the Metropolitan Diary of the New York Times, containing sketches written by people of actual happenings, scenes in the city that they'd witnessed. And one for May 1995 read in this way. It said, "Dear Diary, it was midway during Act 3 of La Traviata at the New York City Opera. And after seeing Alfredo's confession of love, Violetta's rejection of the carefree life of Paris, their retreat to the countryside, but Giorgio's appeal to release Alfredo for the benefit of his sister's prospects of marriage, Violetta's compliance, her pretended deceit, Alfredo's jealous rage, her reversal, an illness, Giorgio's sympathy, the lovers' tragic reunion, and Violetta's death. After all of that, I heard the woman behind me say to her companion, 'The same thing happened to my girlfriend, Gloria.'" Now, when I did that, 300 Italian Irish Catholics just lifted the ceiling, and Nino looked at me like, "What did you do? You know, what did you set off there?" As I used to tell people, I like to draw on the same blending of the grand and prosaic in offering this talk. You know, it could have been said aptly of my dear friend Nino Scalia, as it had been said of the writer Murray Kempton, that he couldn't look at an eye chart in a doctor's office. He couldn't look at an eye chart without taking sides. His life was a life of arguments in the best sense. They kept testing the grounds of principle that were governing our judgments. In the time that Nino was on the court, no one spoke my mind more often. I think Jerry and I had the same sense, case after case. Whether it was his resistance to the constitutional right to abortion or same-sex marriage, or racial preferences, he spoke sharply, going to the core of things. As in the Adirond case in 1995, on the matter of assigning benefits and disabilities based on race, and he wrote that under our Constitution, there can be no such thing as a creditor or a debtor race. In the eyes of the government, we are just one race here. It's American. But he really won the hearts of many of us as he spoke with a tartness not often seen in these opinions, as in his dissent in the case on gay rights in Colorado, a case I was working on, Romer versus Evans, where he said quite aptly that the court was producing a jurisprudence of terminal silliness. And he saw accurately the steps that would lead years later to same-sex marriage. He used to say that he never had a course in logic, and yet the enduring force of his opinions arose from the fact that he was the most relentless logician on the court. In the Rapanos case in 2006, a case on wetlands, the government sought to extend its controls on anything plausibly wet. And Justice Kennedy argued for an expansive definition which would cover just about any body of water, moving or still, which could affect navigable waters. And Nino replied with a question, by what plausible linguistic usage would we accept that whatever affects waters of the United States is waters of the United States? That which is like waters of the United States is not itself waters of the United States. Or then it would be, whatever affects waters that may affect waters that affect waters. And Nino said, yeah, it's turtles all the way down. Right, 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 right. Use that old line. Well, I'd said, Nino, a good day's work, a bit of propositional logic that establishes the limits to the reach of a federal statute. And I used to say that when he was in dissent, I would read the dissent first, then read the opinion of the court to see if it could meet his argument. But as these arguments were pursued to the root, to the deep principles that underlie our judgments, as Jerry said, the judgments about the things that are just or unjust, right or wrong, this is where we had our sharpest disagreement. I don't think he really ever did accept the notion of moral truths, by the way. No, the people of Indiana could impose those judgments. That didn't mean they were true. It was their right to impose judgments. That's a longer argument. I've been part of this project of restoring the understanding of natural law and the doctrines of natural rights as understood by the American founders and Lincoln. And Nino, as Jerry suggests, had long ago absorbed the dubiety of natural rights expressed by Justice Holmes. Holmes, who hoped that every word of moral significance could be purged from the law altogether. And Nino scoffed at the natural law as though it were something hazy and high-minded floating in the air over us, not, as his other friends sought to tell him, that involved the deepest axioms of what we know, of the things so fundamental and so evidently true that we may hardly even be aware of them any longer. And instead of being hazy, they are the things that form the ground of our practical judgments. Is that we cast moral judgments only on things in the domain of freedom. If Jones is thrown out the window on the way down, lands on Smith, we don't hold Jones responsible for an assault. We say one of the first principles is people cannot be held blameworthy or responsible for acts they were powerless to effect. It's a necessary truth, and we could draw others from it. But if you'll permit me, I'd like to take my entry into the subject from a rather different angle. To see what the natural law is, what was at stake, I draw an old line of mine in pointing out that the comedians are often the same business as the philosophers, because they draw their material from the shades of meaning and logic found in the language. You think of Groucho, the famous scene, Groucho leaving a party one night and stops to talk to the hostess and says, I've had a lovely evening. This wasn't it. Now, we had Mr. Richard Leder used to offer his entertainment to the country drawn from the papers of undergraduates containing items of this kind, that Socrates was a Greek teacher who died from an overdose of wedlock. That Louis Pasteur discovered a cure for rabbis. Sir Francis Drake circumcised the world with a 100-foot clipper. That Bach was the most famous composer of his age, and so was Handel. And Handel was large. He was one half English, one half German, and one half Italian. Now, you realize you have to absorb, usually the interval between the line and the laugh could be measured in milliseconds, but you'd have to absorb a whole system of logic in order to laugh so quickly what's going on. At times the joke would touch things that people would take as the anchoring axioms of their lives. Like Bertrand Russell's joke about Mrs. Christine Franklin Ladd, who's a solipsist, who couldn't be sure there's anyone in the world apart from herself. But she's so disappointed she couldn't find other solipsists to come to meetings. Now, if our ears were as well trained, we would induce the same urbane gigglings when we hear this line, which must be the most well-traveled fallacy in our public discourse. If there were these truths that would be that are true in all places and all times, they would be recognized in all places, and the very fact that they're not is prima facie evidence that there are no such truths. Now, the philosopher would tell us that argument simply reduces to this proposition, that the very presence of disagreement marks the absence of truth, but of course I register my disagreement with that proposition, and by its own terms, that establishes its falsity. That took about 6 seconds. And yet Harry Blackmun was willing to establish a whole branch of our jurisprudence on precisely that self-refuting proposition that collapses in 6 seconds. With Harry Blackmun, it went this way. When so many learned people in philosophy and law and religion cannot establish the question of when human life begins, obviously there is no answer that the judges are in a position to render. Okay? The jolting thing here to notice is Scalia's own objection to natural law fell precisely into this argument, that we cannot use natural law because there's too much disagreement on it. Therefore, we doubt that the truths really are there. But those arguments collapsed because they fell into self-contradiction. They simply run afoul of the laws of reason. And what Scalia had trouble in seeing was that the natural law found its ground precisely in what Aristotle saw as the thing most distinctive to human beings. Aquinas said the divine law we know through revelation, but the natural law we know through that reasoning that is accessible to human beings as human beings, we might say, natural to human beings. In my own teaching, ladies and gentlemen, I found that the preeminent example of that kind of reasoning, which heard at once, is instantly understood by people across the ages, and that's simply that fragment Lincoln wrote for himself, in which he imagined himself engaged in a conversation with an owner of slaves, putting the question, why are you justified in making a slave of the black man? Is it because he's less intelligent than you? Beware, the next white man who comes along, more intelligent than you, may rightly enslave you. It's because he's darker than you, or I'll beware again, the next white man who comes along with a complexion even lighter than yours may enslave you. The upshot is there's nothing one could cite to disqualify the black man that wouldn't apply to many whites as well. I point out, nowhere in the chain of reasoning is there an appeal to faith or revelation. It is simply principled reasoning. It is accessible to people across the religion. Catholics, atheists, Baptists, Chicago Cub fans can understand this. You don't need to be a genius. And of course, as Jerry knows, many of us have drawn on precisely the same mode of reasoning in arguing about abortions. We raise the question, why is that offspring in the womb anything less than human? Doesn't speak yet, neither do deaf mutes. Doesn't have arms or legs. Other people lose arms or legs in the course of their lives without losing anything necessary as human beings to the protection of their lives under the law. Okay? And the point is, you don't have to be Catholic to understand this, but that has been precisely the teaching of the church, that you don't have to be Catholic to understand this, because this is natural law reasoning. Now, Nino offered this paradox, as I often told him. He spent his life deriding natural law, but he continued to give us handsome examples of how a jurisprudence of natural law could be done. The natural law found its grounds in those laws of reason, and Scalia was doing the work of natural law as it continued in that dogged, relentless way in testing the arguments before the court in a demanding way. And so in the Lawrence case that Jerry mentioned, Justice O'Connor sought to finesse the issue of same-sex marriage by insisting that preserving the traditional institution of marriage is a legitimate interest of the state. There were reasons to sustain marriage without casting any moral disapproval on the homosexual life. Justice Scalia pointed out the trick of the eye engaged here. So he said, preserving traditional institution of marriage is just a kind of way of describing the state's moral disapproval of same-sex couples. Texas's interest could be recast in similarly euphemistic terms, preserving traditional sexual mores of our society. In the jurisprudence Justice O'Connor has seemingly created, judges can validate laws by characterizing them as preserving the traditions of society. Good. Or invalidate them by characterizing them as expressing moral disapproval. Bad. His writing was pointed, piercing, going to the logical core, but gaining in rhetorical force as it moved to the end. But then also in delivery. He was often angry and incredulous at the outcome, but the dissent was read with an anger subdued, read with a calm voice, perhaps the voice of a father, seeking with some disappointment and regret to explain to the family, gathered round, that something had gone wrong here. So he told me one day, I read that dissent. I was in the court, I had been in the court that day. I had read that dissent because there were reporters there. He said, wouldn't you think they'd be interested in the First Amendment? His colleagues had just sustained a law in Colorado aimed so evidently at one class of demonstrators, pro-lifers outside an abortion clinic. Nina hoped that the sympathies of the media might be recruited to support the freedom of speech, even of people they found uncongenial. But the sober lesson breaking through was that the pro-lifers alone would be left out of the protections of speech that Nina had been seeking to expand. When it came, though, to the force of dissents read aloud, as Jerry suggested, nothing compared with a dissent he delivered in 2013 in the Windsor case, when the court virtually teed up the decision it would render a year later in proclaiming same-sex marriage as a constitutional right. And he said, to defend traditional marriage is not to condemn, demean, or humiliate those who prefer other arrangements. In the majority's judgment, any resistance to its holdings is beyond the pale of reasoned disagreement. He says, it is one thing for society to elect change. It's another for a court of law to impose change by judging those who oppose it as hostis humani generis, enemies of the human race. Maureen Scalia had urged her husband to read that dissent that morning, and I could see as he read it its effect on her. I was just a few seats away from her. If Nino hadn't read that dissent that morning, we could hardly have walked upright out of the courtroom that day. He caught there what we'd see played out with a venomous, unbending force a year later, as the votaries of same-sex marriage would seek to bring down the hammer of the law on such luminaries as bakers and florists. These were ordinary people who would not confess the rightness of same-sex marriage and therefore confess their wrongness in opposing it. But the logic of the matter, Nino saw at work as early as Romer versus Evans, and even more sharply in the case Jerry mentioned, Lawrence versus Texas, when the court struck down the notably unenforced law on sodomy in Texas. Justice Kennedy insisted that his decision that day entailed no further formal recognition of the homosexual relation, that is, no recognition of marriage, to which Nino famously said, do not believe it, for the premises were firmly in place. Justice Kennedy said that people in homosexual relations seek autonomy for themselves, just as people in heterosexual relations do. The two stood on the same moral plane. Kennedy helped to plant the point that the laws may not cast an adverse judgment on the homosexual life. The laws that permit marriage only to couples of the opposite sex, and yet withhold that recognition from couples of the same sex, could be seen then as holding back from conferring this recognition on homosexual couples only because of an adverse moral judgment, a judgment now stamped as deeply wrong. So Scalia summed it up. This case does not involve the issue of homosexual marriage. Only if one entertains the belief that principle and logic have nothing to do with the decisions of this court. And there was, in his approach, no magic powers of prediction or foresight. It was simply a matter of drawing out the logical implications of what his colleagues were doing and pointing out exactly where they were tending. In our persistent jousting, he would deride natural law, and I'd keep pointing out to him the cases in which he was constantly backing into it. And so in that notable case of assisted suicide in Oregon, Gonzales versus Oregon, Nino invoked the logic of the Hippocratic Oath, that there was a rightful purpose in the medical art and the use of drugs, that the purpose was to secure the health of the patient, not to speed him to his death. To put it another way, death could not stand as a rival good to life. We could not imagine an ambulance service constituted on the premise that the task was to hurry to the scene of the injury and dispatch the victim quickly so that the relatives would be spared any difficult decisions. We could not imagine an ambulance service or hospital constituted on any other purpose than to preserve life and health, not to use their powers to administer death to the patient. Justice Kennedy listened to this and said, well, that is one interesting and legitimate view. And Nino just about shot up like a Minuteman III. You know, one? That is one legitimate view? It is, he said, three times he said, it is the only natural interpretation. I said, natural? You mean natural as a kind of a reflex? You do this and you kick. Well, no, it can't be that, because he knew that Janet Reno, in the previous administration, the Attorney General, reached a different decision. So he must have meant natural in the sense of unreasonable, unreasonable. His was a common sense very much anchored in the world as we lived it. And one of his distinctive moves as a judge, one of the things I've savored, was when he drew out the implications of those novel rights created by the court. In that Cruzan case in 1990 that Jerry referred to, the court was being invited to create nothing less than a new constitutional right to die, a right that would license vast new mischiefs in the land and unsettle many parts of our law. But it was not beyond the imagining of Scalia. He leaned in with that special knack of drawing out the principled implications of these novel rights. And so he said, I want to offer a word of advice to those people who are running ambulances and hospitals and who are persistently summoned to the rescue. If you're a hospital service run by the state and you're called on to pump out the stomach of someone who has intentionally taken an overdose of barbiturates, you are not going to be subject to a suit under 42 U.S. 1983 for violating the civil rights of this man. What civil right? Some new constitutional right to die by his own hand. No one came close to Scalia in drawing out the implications of these principles for our lives daily led. And this mode of reasoning reached a sublime level, I thought, when he managed to show that certain rights claimed by litigants were so exquisite and refined that they virtually extinguish themselves. But I'll reserve that for our discussion and put that aside right now. Years ago, in an oral argument before the court, Nina was bearing down like an ongoing train heading on this lawyer. This poor lawyer was standing there trying to hold on to something. And the lawyer finally made a gesture of surrender with the plea. Justice Scalia, I want to invoke my constitutional right to be presumed innocent. Presumed innocent. Gee, where was that in the text of the Constitution? Not in mine. But we knew it was there. It was one of those deep principles that would be there in a regime of law, even if there were no Constitution. And there in a flash was this fascinating puzzle that would run through my dear friend's jurisprudence and may explain why he called himself a faint-hearted originalist. Originalists want to be governed by the framer, by the words in the text of the Constitution, how they were understood by the framers. To appeal outside the text marked the courting of danger, true on the suspicion of heresy. And to speak of deeper principles underlying the text, principles that would be there even if the text were not there, well, that was to whisper the logic of, gasp, natural law. But as I say, he was a relentless logician. As he sought the logic behind the text, he persistently found himself reasoning back to those principles. Actually, you mentioned the Second Amendment, the Heller case. That's a fine point. Because I remember having lunch with him, and I said, in the Heller case, you invoked the right of self-preservation. I assumed you meant the right of an innocent person to fend off an unjustified assault. I said, quite right. I said, well, those words aren't in the Second Amendment. So I was wondering, were you saying that James Wilson and Blackstone said those words and a lot of people read them at the time? Or were you appealing to some deep principle whose validity does not depend on being mentioned anywhere in the text? Let's see. If it's the first one, then say you're turning jurisprudence to legislative history. We have to find out how many people who voted for the Second Amendment actually read Blackstone and Wilson. And even if we could get the answer to that question, it would not be to the answer to the question that we're asking, which is there in fact a deep principle that would be there even if there were no Constitution? That first generation of American jurists and lawyers, Alexander Hamilton, John Marshall, James Wilson, showed their genius and remarkable knack of tracing their judgments back to those deep axioms which formed the ground of everything we knew. And they touched the principles or things that would have to be part of our law even if they were never set down in the text. I would keep reminding Scalia of the way his arguments kept moving him beyond the text of those the Constitution to those principles that would have to be there even if there were no Constitution. But as a final point, when it came to that need to reach beyond the text to the principles of truth that were there before the Constitution, there was no issue that ran deeper here than the issue of abortion. Nina would say, and he said it in Rome, as Jerry said, that if a legislature provided for the most radical licensing of abortion on demand, there is nothing he could do to call that law into question and extend the protections of the law around that small human in the womb. From the perspective of those who see this matter through the lens of natural law, the question is, what is the ground of principle on which the law may remove a whole class of human beings from the circle of rights-bearing beings who may be subject to the protections of the law? Can you do it simply by shifting names? That's not a person, that's a nigger. That's not a person, that's a fetus. Could that be low enough to do it? I then, in responding to Nino, muse of the question of what the judges would have done if the understanding had settled in quite early that those Civil War amendments applied only to blacks who'd become human. For after all, we've been told that not everything conceived of humans is human at all times and stages. And so the matter should be returned to the states, as Scalia himself would declare. Scalia declared that the justices have no more competence in deciding the question of when human life begins than the first nine names in the telephone directory. We send that back to the states. Now, does anyone really believe that judges in our own day would have no questions to raise if the states decided that children were more human as they were lighter in complexion, scored higher on verbal tests? Scalia would not have been the least bewildered by a law of that kind. We know exactly the kinds of questions that Scalia would press. We know that the judges have the modes of argument readily at hand to identify the grounds that were thoroughly arbitrary in making discriminations here between those with a claim to live and those whose lives may be taken without the need to render a justification. So why then should we suppose that judges in our own day would encounter an inscrutable problem if they found humans in the womb put outside the protection of the law because of their height, weight, because they're lacking limbs, or hadn't acquired yet the facility to speak and do syllogisms? Well, these are the arguments about the natural law. I hope to resume with him one day if I could be fortunate enough to have his company again in a better place. But something nags at me, though, that with the fear that before I can see him again, the ones I love, I may be compelled to spend a long time in purgatory listening to Joe Biden. Nino told me one night at supper, a woman said to him, "Mr. Justice, we know you love children." He stopped. He said, "Why would you say that?" He said, "Well, you have nine of them." He says, "No, that means I love my wife." He loved Maureen, and he loved that remarkable family of five boys and four girls that they'd woven together of love and the steadiest, most unwavering religious commitment, the commitment that had everyone bundled into the station wagon for Sunday Mass with a church across Chicago, with Nino driving, as Paul Scalia said, driving in a ride of 30 minutes to a church 40 minutes away. And the day after he died, and we're still absorbing the shock, Father Paul called us together late in the afternoon on Sunday for private Mass with the family. And Gene Scalia, the oldest boy, remarked as we gathered that night that among Nino's achievements was, in fact, this family he had woven together with Maureen. Nine children, remarked, all serious Catholics, all loving each other, clinging to each other as they loved and respected the mom and dad who brought them forth. And on the day of that moving funeral, as we were joined by an army of people, we couldn't help but notice this other signal achievement. They brought forth a son who was an accomplished, gifted priest. Father Lamb remarked on the wonderful homily that Paul delivered that day. An accomplished, gifted priest. What better thing could a man have than a son directing with understanding and love his own funeral and bringing him to his resting place? When my wife Judy, my dearest friend, died suddenly a little more than a year ago, Nina was quite broken up as he and Maureen joined me for a memorial mass in the small chapel that, Judy loved. I was in the first row of this chapel with my family, and there was no kneeler there. And as I knelt, I felt the pain of the floor. But just behind me, Nino noticed, and he slipped a cushion under my knees. And Maureen later told me, said she was surprised he'd noticed, and she's surprised that he moved instantly to, do something. And a note after he died, my friend David Forte, who was there, recalled that moment. And he said, Nino had been my protector at that moment, as he had been, in his own way, the protector of us all. His writing, his recorded speeches will be there to instruct the young and the old, and even to entertain for years to come. People will learn from those writings as long as the young of this country will know how to read. We'll never lose him in that sense, but our days are simply wanting now in the kind of laughter and the love he diffused to us and throughout the land. But as I was writing this, I thought he'd hate to have me end on a sad note. And I have a hunch, I think there was one line of mine he just loved and he called a terrific exit line. And maybe just out of memory of Nino, I might recall it, I was saying, to rework an old line, there really is a moral world. There's a world of moral up and down with right and wrong answers. The only question is, how far is it from Midtown? How late does it stay open? Ladies and gentlemen, I've had a lovely evening, and this was it.
Thank you, Professors Arkes and Bradley. And I'd like to close with just a few words from Father Scalia's homily at the funeral mass for his father. Let us not show him a false love and allow our admiration to deprive him of our prayers. We continue to show affection for him and do good for him by praying for him, that all stain of sin may be washed away, that all wounds be healed, that he be purified of all that is not Christ. And so may the soul of Antonin Scalia and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.